If you smile to the defendant, you must smile to the other side as well. If you intervene and say now that's enough because the defendant is being unruly, you have to be harsh also to the other side. So it's not so they balance their emotional displays. It's very important to the extent that they actually have an emotional displays at all, and that varies between different judges. Or like one of the judges, he had this court clerk, young, inexperienced female court clerk next to him after a case like that. And what he did to comfort her was to buy her a six-pack of beer and say, go home and drink this. And he went home and drank a whole bottle of vodka. So it's like they don't need any kind of debriefing. They don't need to talk to psychologists because they are professional. You know, they don't have emotions, so the saying goes. So they're supposed to have a Teflon structure that where the emotions just fall off them. So the idea of, and when we get to the topic of objectivity, it's this idea of blind justice. Now, I see that she has a body, but the body has been left out of the story. So actually, the idea of contemporary objectivity in the courts goes that we have no bodies, we are actually just machines, and we're actually just giving the verdict that any computer could give, which is kind of strange, because in the long run it would mean that judges wouldn't be needed, but they're very self-conscious and sure that they are needed anyway. So I want to problematize the idea of blind justice as something that is objectivist in the positivist sense, and I want to highlight the body of justice, which is actually a situated body and a feeling body, right? The theoretical point of departure then is what we call the radical perspective in sociology of emotions, holding that emotion and rationality cannot be separated, that they're actually always entangled and go together. So, and this is corroborated by a whole lot of other previous research, especially in other disciplines such as neuropsychiatry, showing that when you take rational decisions or when you pursue rational goals, you have an emotional element involved in that too. So, and if we actually become somehow disconnected from our emotions through a brain. Brain problem or something, or a concussion, or not a concussion, but the brain bleeding, for instance. then we actually lose the capacity to take even the simplest decisions in everyday life, because there are so many possible choices that we can make, and so many rational, purely rational calculations that we would have to make in order to take that decision, that our everyday sort of courses of routine and everyday lives would be severely inhibited if we didn't have emotions that guided us and guided these rational decisions. So he entirely constructs the idea of instrumentality as something that is driven by emotion, motivated by emotion, and also facilitated by emotion. And not only emotions of what you sort of are doing it for the moment, but also emotions towards the things that would disrupt your goal-oriented instrumental action, such as distaste for waste of material and time. So, and these emotions that are facilitating and that are rarely visible, we don't actually conceive of them as emotional states. Jack Barbalay calls background emotions, emotions that are in the background. They are still there, they're still sort of orienting our actions, and our, especially our goal-oriented instrumental rationality, but they are often mistaken for non-emotion because they're not visible, and they're just below the consciousness, or the conscious, just below the level of consciousness, he says. Foreground emotions, on the other hand, would be emotions that we are aware of and that are more highly visible, like when we see somebody and conventionally would say, that person is now emotional, like very angry, very sad, or very happy. And these emotions, in turn, are typically the object of conscious cognitive emotion management, what Arlie Hochschild has coined as feeling and display rules, which are socioculturally specific. So in also in different contexts, in a specific society, you will find specific context specific feeling and display rules governing how emotions should be expressed and which emotions should be felt in which situations. Why do we have to do this, a qualitative project? Because we have to really dig and work on methods and ways to undig the emotions that are actually there and make them talk about emotions without making them feel that they are not being professional. Because the standard version would be that if I say that I have emotions as a judge, I'm not professional, right? So our methods have been particularly shadowing, which is a method where you do observations by following people around. So we have followed judges and prosecutors from everything from 2 days up to 2 weeks. We have also observed more than 300 court cases in connection to these shadowings. We have interviewed them repeatedly, both one long interview and small interviews that, to fill in and to validate what we have seen in our observations. And that amounts to about 120 in-depth interviews. So we have an enormous amount of data. And we have today also a lot of field notes from our observations and shadowings in between the different court cases, from lunchrooms, from offices, and so on. But the overall purpose then was quite broad, to explore emotions in the emotion management in and of the Swedish court, with a focus on judges and prosecutors, because judges and prosecutors are civil servants and they are the ones most bounded by the idea of positivist objectivity and non-emotionality, like, you know, in Weber's bureaucratic sense, right? We argue and we haven't looked specifically at that, but there are others who have done it. And there are actually also research showing that the Swedish court come out with very biased decisions in terms of race, class, and especially gender. You know, rape cases, abuse cases of different kinds, children's abuse and so on. Those cases are very often acquitted because it goes, there is not enough evidence because we only have two parties, and the one was the victim and the other one was the perpetrator, and then we have no objective, we have word against word and there is no objective evidence, so we can't really convict and we have to acquit. And this happens over and over again. Plus there is an overweight of racial aspects in the convictions of the Swedish courts, like you tend to get convicted if you come from a specific suburb, if you're a migrant, if you have a specific class background, and so on. So the idea of positivist objectivity, the problem here also, is that this maintenance of an objectivity ideal is actually making justice less objective or less impartial, because judges and prosecutors are, after all, people that come from highly educated and most often upper class segments of society, and they have no clue of the reality of the people they are actually convicting. Starting to look at the topic of objectivity in court, we had one previous work actually dealing with this, and it's Jacobson 2008, who investigated the objectivity of prosecutors, and she did not really involve the idea of emotion work and emotions, but she said that we should rather speak, when it comes to prosecutors, we must speak about objectivity as a process and something that is being done and performed all the time. It's not one thing, so to speak. Again, against the idea of positivist objectivity. So we were inspired by this. She actually speaks about objectivity work rather than objectivity. And inspired by this, we want to show that enactment of objectivity relies on emotion work. So there is emotion work behind the objectivity work, if you want. And what we work with then is the idea of an emotive cognitive judicial frame. And the emotive cognitive judicial frame is what we have coined out of our research as a type of behavioral script or habitus for law professions. So it's a way of orienting your emotions and a way of focusing your cognitive attention and working on your emotions, which is implicitly learned through legal education, law school, and then it continues through years of training from the time when you are this clerk who sits there next to the judge to when you decide to become a judge or a prosecutor, and you go, it's quite many years before you actually attain the status of an employed prosecutor or judge. And this is something you learn to work on, and in the beginning actually when we have talked to them, people like the clerks or the very new prosecutors, they are very acutely aware of how they should work on their emotions. They talk about emotion work much more than the professional experienced ones, because the experienced ones have habituated this manner of working on their emotions, right? So this is a way to see how it changes with experience and how it becomes part of your body and part of your performance of doing doing the prosecutor or doing the judge. And when it comes to the emotive cognitive judicial frame, we argue that it orients attention, the attention of the legal professional, through aesthetic pleasure, confidence and interest in their legal skills, and in legal encoding and procedural correctness. It orients their emotional engagement with the case, that is their empathic scope, by focusing on the goal orientation. And there is feeling rules involved in this. You should actually not take in the whole atrocity of a case, but focus on the legal encoding, for instance. It provides, obviously, emotional distance, so you don't get too involved. It postulates also a balanced and composed emotional expression if you express emotions. So there is a display rule in this. And it provides emotional sanctions. So if you transgress these rules, you feel proud of yourself, if you transgress them, you feel ashamed of yourself as a professional. But if you fulfill them in a good way, you feel very proud. So if we exemplify this with the emotion work of objectivity for the judge. Now, an example of taking aesthetic pleasure in balanced and composed emotional display would be when the judge says, and they often say so, that you cannot intervene when you sit in the court, you cannot intervene with the one side more than you do on the other side, so to speak. Now, you have to know that the Swedish court, in the Swedish court, the judges are extremely passive. They do nothing. They're not supposed to do anything, and it's really, really bad if they ask a question that somehow tips the case in favor of the defense or the prosecution, right? Especially, their special focus is on the defendant, the accused, because the accused, they say, is the one that stands to lose and to get to go to prison, so that's the person they are most sensitive to. And it follows somehow by the emotive cognitive judicial frame that in this they quite often forget the victim and the victim's whatever suffering, because the victim after all is not going to prison, so you know, and the most harsh decision a judge can take is to sentence somebody to prison, to take away their you know, their rights of freedom of movement as individuals and citizens and so on. So they are very acutely aware of this. And it goes that they tend to be harsher, in reality, they tend to be harsher to the prosecuting side and more lenient to the defendant. But in ideally, they should balance their both sides. They take a great pride and interest in the goal of sentencing. That's their goal, right? They go in, they normally, a Swedish judge has not looked at the case before, shouldn't have looked at the case before. All the protocols and so on from the investigation are available to the judge, but normally he or she has not looked at it before. Because the idea is he walks in you know, in the name of blind justice, the person, the woman or man judge walks in and sits at the court and listens to what the parties has to say. Everything has to be oral, direct, which is again a construction, because obviously all these people have been heard hundreds of times before, right? And repeated their stories hundreds of times, but it should be repeated as if it was the first time in court. So they go in, they sit there, they listen, and they have one goal: to determine if the evidence is enough to convict the accused. And then again, they take great pride in, you know, not being judgmental on the part of the accused. Again, focuses on the accused. So here we have a judge saying, just because you dislike rapists and dislike those who abuse small children, it is a defendant sitting there, perpetrator. That's up to me to decide, right? So it's never a perpetrator until the judge has decided. The defendant can never be guilty until it's until sentenced. And that's one holy rule of objective justice. They also take great confidence in procedural correctness. And here you see an element of collaboration in the courts, because as I said, the judge is passive. He's not supposed to ask any investigative questions. So the judge relies on the prosecutor to do his or her job well in that respect. And that means that sometimes the prosecutor might be quite inexperienced or might be just a bad prosecutor, and the questions that need to be asked for the judge to make his or her decision are not asked. And if this is not asked, even if you can find it in the investigation, in the protocols, the judge cannot use it. It has to be said and expressed in court. So the judges can be, or are quite often, very irritated with prosecutors who don't ask these questions that must be asked for the judge to be able to sentence. But they cannot express that, and they should not care about it. So it is the role of the prosecutor, one judge says, to pursue the plea on behalf of the state. I'm merely evaluating the evidence. So the emotion work of the prosecutor is quite different. There is one overall goal orientation in terms of objectivity, and that is oriented by pride in the ability to switch between on and off, engagement, non-engagement, regarding the strength of a case. So it means that, as I said, prosecutor needs to be objective in the investigation phase. And when you follow a prosecutor in the investigation, he or she will one day be like, yeah, we got something more on this bastard, you know? And the next day they will be, well, maybe we have to acquit. Maybe we have to just let go, because we couldn't get through there and there, we didn't get that witness statement. Now, when it comes to the evidence and the amount of evidence needed in order to prosecute, as I said, they have to have enough evidence for it to be objectively likely that a person will be convicted. So they have to let go of many cases where they have almost enough of evidence and so on. But this is a paramount sacred value to the prosecutor, to be able to disconnect this way. So you have here one prosecutor who's very experienced saying, if you can't manage to get enough supporting evidence, then you must be honest and fair, because in this lies the objectivity. I mean, I have no prestige. To me, the issue is not whether I win or lose. That's not what you do as a prosecutor. The most important thing is to make the right decision, so you don't contribute to innocent people being convicted. You must rather let 10 guilty people walk than to convict a single innocent. So I think that is quite illustrating of the very strong emotional orientation and pride that they take in being able to let go of a case, right? The thing is that they are closer to the case in terms of reading the protocols over and over again from the police hearings and so on, sometimes even sitting in on the hearings with themselves. Mostly it's the police that conducts the hearings with a all the witnesses and people involved in the case. But as they read the text that they get from the police, they are constantly thinking in terms of legal codes, and they're constantly coding the material. So that gives them already a very a specific type of distance to the text, and it also, as I said, limits their empathic scope, so they don't have to be too involved, they don't have to imagine the whole atrocity of a horrible crime, for instance. So when a prosecutor says, some cases do affect me a lot, but most of them I just read with a focus on the prerequisites. How can I prove this? And I don't put myself in that person's situation. I'm more objective. Reading is like a special kind of detailed dissection. So here she makes the comparison to a surgeon who dissects bodies. Now there's also the aspect of objectivity as a collective achievement, as I mentioned previously when I spoke about how the judge has to sit back and wait for the prosecutor to actually provide enough evidence in the oral hearings, in the court process. But there are also other aspects to this. And it happens now and then that the lay people that come into court, and mind you, the lay people are the first people that the legal professionals mention when you speak about emotions. They say, oh yeah, but the lay people are emotional. They can be very emotional, whereas we, the professionals, are not emotional beings, you know. So it's like it is, you also have this ranking of rationality being on top, and the emotional ones being the unprofessional ones, seen in this separation between emotion and reason onto different parties in the court or different actors in the court. And it does happen, of course, that we have quite emotional, in the conventional sense, interventions by lay people in the court. And then this is handled very often as a professional collaboration thing. Like we all, both the prosecutor and the judge, or even the lawyer sometimes, step in to somehow cool or ease the situation and turn, you know, keep up the image of unemotional, objective justice. Now, the last example is on emotional sanctions, pride and shame. As I mentioned before, the emotive-cognitive judicial frame sanctions correct behavior in the as a court professional or as a legal professional by providing emotions about emotions, basically. So you feel proud when you do the right thing and ashamed when you do the wrong thing, also in terms of emotion work, not only in terms of the sort of rules around how you should behave cognitively or behaviorally. So here's we have only examples of judges here, actually, but quite illustrating ones. When the judge manages to balance respectful display, which is something which is very much talked about now in the courts, that we should be respectful to the lay people, not treat them in a condescending way. But then again, you shouldn't be emotional or attaching to them, so you have to do that with a distance. So when the judge manages this balance, they take enormous pride in this professional achievement, right? Now, if you fail, as I said before, with the example of the note being passed to the prosecutor, if you fail, there is enormous professional embarrassment. And that goes for even if it's not your own failure. It's, they identify very much with the idea of justice at large. And this is a quote from a person who overheard, a judge who overheard another judge when she was getting too involved in the victim. And she says, I felt like, oh no, good Lord, I mean, quiet, quiet, quiet. Like, do not say one more word. It was so wrong. What she said was so value loaded, and I thought it was so unprofessional. We aim to show, I hope I have shown some of it today, that there are lots of emotions and emotion work engaged to in the purpose of upholding the idea of objectivity in court. Now, that is not to say that we shouldn't be objective or that we can't be objective, but the actual situated work of objectivity looks quite different from the idea of positivist objectivity, which is disembodied and non-situated and comes from point zero somewhere. The The ideal, however, is upheld and sustained by the emotive-cognitive judicial frame, which still postulates positivist objectivity. So if you ask them about objectivity, they will give you this standard notion of positivist objectivity, in spite of knowing that they don't work that way. And this, and it's done also through the providing of feeling and display rules that orient professional emotion work towards instrumental rationality. And this emotive cognitive judicial frame, as I said, is monitored or supremely governed by the feelings of shame and pride. Actual objectivity, we argue, is situated and differs depending on work tasks and goal orientation. So as we saw, there are different orientations and different challenges for judges and prosecutors in order to fulfill the goal of objectivity. And in the court, as I said, judges and prosecutors often engage in concerted action to sustain the notion of positivist objectivity. So it's often, quite often, at least as far as the court goes or the court process, a collective achievement. Then when it comes to the emotionality of cases, obviously, that is another part of the professional ethos that, you know, you're not supposed to, since you as a judge and a prosecutor do not have any emotions, that's so the saying goes, right? Nor are you supposed to be personally affected by any kind of crime or atrocity. So when it happens, and it typically happens in cases where you have child pornography, for example, right? Child pornography is often full of evidence because you can find in the accused computer, you know, lots of material. So from the evidence point of view, it's rarely a problem. But in many cases, the courts have to sit through and look, watch these videos. And there we have the strongest direct emotional accounts from judges who have done that, saying that it was the most horrible and disgusting thing they've ever been had to, you know, go through ever in their work. And they dealt with it taking breaks, going to the toilet, crying, and then going back and again being neutral. And so we have talked to, that's basically the reason why we have also interviewed and in some cases also shadowed the court clerks, because the court clerks are the ones, they are new baked from law school. Where we have lots of examples of court clerks actively, or describing how they actively work to be unemotional, you know. And actually, if you look at the courtroom and you sit through a whole court case, you can often see that the one who is most stone-faced is the court clerk. The judge can sometimes, you know, raise their eyebrows or smile a little bit or something. The court clerk, not even if everybody starts laughing, might not even laugh, because they're working so hard not to express anything, you know. And when you talk to them, they will say, oh, but you're not allowed to have any emotions here, and it's really hard, and sometimes when I go home, I have to process everything with my boyfriend or my, you know. So they really talk about how they actively try to think of not expressing any emotions. And then you also have the case with, as a shaming example, the case with a girl who, for personal reasons, was very uncomfortable with rape cases. So as a court clerk, she felt that she should, but she didn't dare to ask to be not have to go to these cases. And I asked her about it, and I said, so what, why don't you ask about it? And she said, no, but you know, then they will say that I'm not suited as a prospective judge. So I can't do that. And then I actually talked to her supervisor, the judge she was sitting with, and I didn't mention this, I just asked, that's a different question, I asked, so what if the court clerk or any person wouldn't feel comfortable with some specific cases? And then he just laughed and he said, well, then they wouldn't suit as judges. They wouldn't be suited as judges. So this is how they, you know, they And that would be a horrible shame to. I mean, the shaming processes are very interesting when it comes to becoming a judge, because becoming a judge is a whole story in Sweden where you're totally and for a very long time elected and evaluated by other judges. And this goes for a system that obviously selects some certain people and doesn't really approve of others. Again, some kind of bias process. So you have a specific type of people being judges, definitely. Very often upper class, very often white, Swedish, and so on. And then the learning process is also quite interesting because, as I said, they sit stone-faced. So this is an example of mimicking, like mimicking postures, mimicking expressions, mimicking ways of behaving.